Good day, friends. I am Gurumurthy from IT for Change. IT for Change is an NGO that works on using ICTs for social change at local, national, and global levels. We work on different domains of governance, gender, technology governance, education, etc. More information about our work is available on our website www.itforchange.net, and our work on the free and open source software in India is available on the website public-software.in. My talk over the next 10 minutes will cover briefly the government role in fast adoption, the idea of public software, our own work in public software adoption, the challenges that we are facing, and what our plans for the future are. We all know that government is a very big actor in society, particularly in developing countries like India, Brazil, South Africa. Government has a very big share of the economic activity, and therefore the adoption of free and open source software in government would have a very large impact on its adoption in society. However, we find that with exceptions like Brazil, not much activity has happened on actual adoption by governments. And we think that here it's very important for us to frame the debate in a meaningful way which supports our cause. When we talk about open source, it's seen as a technology issue by many government bureaucrats, and they immediately say they want to be neutral between open source and closed source. Also, we know that governments are not very keen on developing or maintaining source code in-house, so the open source advantage does not seem to be very important for them. On the other hand, we have been explaining free and open source to governments using the language of public good provisioning, which is something that they understand very well. Governments, particularly in the countries that developing countries that we belong to, clearly understand the value of public provisioning of public goods, which all need but cannot be universally provided by the market. For example, public education is a must for universal education. We have private schools. However, we know that unless there are government schools, we cannot guarantee education for every citizen, every child in the country. Similarly, public health is a must for universal health coverage. Now, we find that society, the today's society we call information society, is because of the explosion of information and communication. And this information society is largely based on its digital nature. Basically, it is software that makes such a digital society or information society possible. So we say that just like there is a right to education and right to health, we need to understand there is a right to basic software that everybody needs, such as operating system, text, number, video, audio editors, web browsers. And we say we need to see this as public software, which everybody must have to participate in the information society. Without accessing these software applications, citizens will not be able to participate. And that is a deprivation of their basic rights. And therefore, governments are obliged to ensure universal access to public software. We argue that only free software can be public software because the freedom to modify and share is absolutely important for both universal access. It is also important for community participation, which is an important part of all public services. Whereas private provision doesn't have to have community participation, whatever the government provides needs to have public participation. We argue that while free software has been there for quite some time and free software communities have produced free software, however, we cannot depend only on voluntary effort of free software communities or of corporates to create public software. And just as in the case of public education and public health, government institutions need to actively cooperate with the free software communities and open source communities, organizations, to collaborate and ensure that free software is available for everybody. We can no longer depend only on voluntary effort of the community or corporate benevolence. We all know the problem that happened to OpenOffice after Oracle took over Sun Microsystems. And therefore, there's a need for a public sector or a government guarantee to make sure that public software is universally available, just as government schools are there and government health centers are there, to guarantee that this is going to be available to all without any restrictions. So what do we do? We work on different aspects. One, we certainly work on advocacy because we see a big role in creating awareness in central government, federal government, state governments on the responsibility to adopt and promote public software as a public good. We have been engaging with the Government of India on its open standards policy. This is a very in very, very pioneering policy from India. I don't think any other country in the world has such a progressive policy which clearly mandates that the government has to use only open standards in its digital documents. And the government actually has notified ODF as the document standard that it must adopt. Similarly, the government has come out with a draft policy on device drivers, which says that all devices should be made available by the hardware vendor, should work not only on proprietary operating system but also on free operating system. So that's our policy and program engagement with central and state governments. But specifically, we are working with the Karnataka Education Department on adopting public education software tool. This is a very large program we are doing with more than 800 schools this year, which will eventually go to 4,000 schools over the next couple of years, on schools adopting a large number of educational tools which are free tools in mathematics, science, social science, etc. We are also studying the adoption of public software in public institutions, which includes government departments and also NGOs. This is a research part of our work because we are all the time trying to understand why is it that public institutions have not picked up public software in a big way? What are the obstacles to public institutions adopting public software? What are the issues to creating an ecosystem for public software? An important part of the ecosystem creation is capacity building. So we do a large number of workshops training people working in government departments, teachers in schools, teacher educators, NGO workers on learning how to use free software. Another important part of our work is to create communities, network communities, both free software communities as well as public sector actors. So we have a network called the FOSCOM network. And the FOSCOM network actually is a group of FOS communities all over the country. And the objective of this network is to engage with the government, both at central level and state level, to see how they can understand the importance of public software. So as you can see, the IT for Change work in this space includes basic capacity building. It includes large-scale programs with the education system and government systems. It includes advocacy at a large level, and it also involves networking. So we are trying to see how through various methods we can promote public software adoption in India on a large scale. However, there are challenges. The obvious challenge is that there has been a history of government departments and free software communities not getting along very well together, because many times software groups have a suspicion of governments, and governments also find that the free software community and other software communities don't engage easily with them. So there is a lot of mistrust. And this mistrust can be very expensive. For example, recently in India, in another state called Punjab, which is as large as Karnataka, both these states have more than 50 million people with around 10 million students. In Punjab, the government had adopted the BOSS Linux system, which is produced by a government organization called CDAC. But after a few years, they went back to proprietary system because they did not get the support of the free software community, which they had not asked for. So this is something that we really need to make sure that the gap between the free software community and government departments doesn't exist, so that mutually they can make the network for public software strong. What are our plans? And our plans are to basically continue our work on research, capacity building, program and advocacy on public software adoption. In Karnataka to start with, which is a large medium-sized state in India, as I said, with a population of 10 million. We also want to extend it to other states in India, as well as other countries in South Asia, like Bhutan, like Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, etc. We are getting support from UNESCO in this venture, and UNESCO had also supported us when we did a workshop a couple of years back with the government of Kerala on public software. We want to create public software centers in many places in India and elsewhere. In fact, we have a public software center in IT for Change itself, and I had mentioned the website to you in the beginning. We want to create such centers all over the country. These public software centers will work with governments to make available the suite of free software tools already available and to encourage government departments to adopt them. We will continue to work with networks of free software communities and government departments to bring them together. We also would like to work with organizations in Brazil, South America and South Africa. I had visited Brazil a couple of years back and had discussions with the Public Software Center folks in Brazil. We would like to take it forward so that public software, whether it's Brazil or South Africa or South Asia, is something that is commonly understood by people working in these countries. That's all from me at this point in time. I'm here to ask you questions. I should be on Skype. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.